Father, we thank you for this time of gathering, this time to get together and be encouraged and bless each other and to see what you have in store for us and connect with you. That's the purpose of this whole gathering time also, not just to gather with everybody else, but to gather and focus this time with you and what you might want to say to us. And so, dear Lord, I just thank you for all those that are here today. I know this winter has been hard on many of us. And so we just praise you and thank you for this time together. In Jesus' name, amen. Oops, the wrong way. He's recording it today for Facebook because now we've been doing that, and some people have been watching and saying that they were glad it was recorded. And bless. So if you, if somebody misses ever, a lot of times he will record it. And I did put all the links on Facebook for the ones that you missed of the messages. And what I'd like to do is get this series of messages and have a personal copy for the church, because these are powerful messages. And they come with a study guide too. And they come with questions and different things, topics, so that it can become a small group. So we can be, you know, it can really discuss what now? What can we do? Starting Over is the name of the message series. And it's been very, very influential to me this month. And I have seen that for some others, it has been very influential too. And so that's why I would love to have a copy of this, and I'm hoping to. We're going to be discussing just a little bit of a review of what the last 4 weeks have entailed. The first one was about three myths. For us to ever start over with anything in our life, there are three myths that grab hold of us, that can't shake us sometimes with our mind. And the three myths we discussed, and I only can remember one or two of them right now off the top of my head, but one of them was, just because we know what to do doesn't mean we will do that. Because we think, oh yeah, I went to counseling, I went to this, I read this, I heard this, I read this book, I did all the good things, you know it all about it. So next time, I know what to do so that I don't repeat the same mistake. How many people here have ever repeated the same mistake? Yeah, me too. I've repeated mistakes. And so, that was the one that, you know, got, that really sunk in my mind. But we will discuss that. That'll be in the thing. If you'd like to join a small group where we discuss this at length, what the three myths were, and all the rest of it, then we will get together. And if we can't meet at a time, then I'll come to your house and show them, and we'll discuss it. And so I want that to be available. The other one was own it. There are times, and they showed a piece of pie, that, you know, you have a piece of pie, and let's say your piece of the pie of maybe the situation of a difficult situation was, you know, your piece of pie was this big, and theirs, or the situation was this big of the piece of pie. Well, he goes on to say that what happens is we focus so much on the larger piece of pie and how much of a problem it was with the people or the situation or the job or the word or this, that, or this thing, that we do not own how it could have been our fault, a little bit of it, this much, this little sliver. And what happens is once we see, yeah, you know what, I had that thought that maybe, it was only for 10 seconds, but I had that thought that maybe I shouldn't have gone there, or maybe I shouldn't have said that, or maybe I shouldn't have gone out with that person because I ended up marrying them, or maybe I should have, you know what, that little tiny thing sometimes is huge. But it was just a little tiny thing at the time. So he expounds on that, how sometimes we have to own what was our fault, even though it's a sliver. Because that releases us. That really helps us to put things in perspective. And then it helps us to take that next step. And so he really said it really funny. What I really liked too was number three, number 16, the 16th that we had 2 weeks ago, rethink it. And what that meant is, could have had a VA. What was I thinking? Why did I go into that situation again or make that decision or say the same thing? Why? And you know what's so funny? Is I had done the same thing. I had gone to the after sale at Walmart, 75% off at Christmas. And it was like, I gotta buy this, I gotta buy that. And then I come back and it was like, why did I buy all that? I was so weak at that time. Some other people, it's something else. Why? What was I thinking? The other thing, you know, could be major. A lot more major than just spending $50 more or $20 more or $5 more. It happens that you make a major decision during a short amount of time. And so, during this thing, all throughout, he was telling us something that I'm going to be sharing again during my message today. Release it. I wasn't here this week, but I did see it. And that's another powerful one. How much of the past are we going to allow to carry into our future? Because what happens, we carry all this past, all these situations, problems we have never let go, release it to God, and we're carrying it, and it keeps us tripping in the future, keeps us miserable in the future, keeps us making the same mistakes in the future. And so as we see this cycle, vicious cycle, he was teaching us how to release it. And one of my favorite things here that we're rethinking was, is we're going to be talking about it in my message too, and you'll see how it was key points for me this week. A lot of us were going through some really heavy stuff this week. And so we're going to be discussing it. And so that's why, what good is starting over? What good is learning about all this wonderful stuff if we don't live it? If it doesn't become real in our life? What happens is a lot of people in a lot of situations forget to focus and think about God in the middle of their trial, in the middle of their discouragement, in the middle. And that's why we're culminating the series of starting over, because how many have made New Year's resolutions, and how many have made new goals for ourselves, and how many, and that's what we're going to be discussing. A lot of us start over many things. How long does it last? We want it to last, some of the things we start over, all the things we start over. And so my question is, and this is some of the questions that we're going to be asking ourselves when we start over. What do you do when everything falls apart? Your career, your marriage, your dream, a death, your health, your relationships, your friendships, your whatever, put it in there. I added a few because in this series it just talks about a couple of these things, but you know what? Sometimes we go through more than just relationship problems, than marriage problems. And so as we go through that, one of the most modern things that I keep hearing, people don't say it in public. I haven't heard anybody say it in public. But I have seen lots of people say, my life. Some of them start with an F. Some of them start with an S. Some of them start with a B. But it's always a curse word. You know? Blank my life. Why? And some of the things are like, really? You're getting worked up over that? Or, oh my goodness, now I see why you're saying that. That's tough. That's rough. That's hard. Empathy. A lot of us have empathy. But you know what? So many people start looking at their life and it's either doom and gloom. And I want to help people, I want to help myself to start over. To start over. Because there's so many things that we can miss, so many blessings we miss by not starting over. So, How do you pick up the pieces and begin again? Those are some of the questions that people ask. Starting over. Making sure that next time doesn't turn out like the last time. That's what the theme has been. And this is what the premises of this series is, that people learn from their mistakes in the areas that matter least. But we repeat our mistakes in the areas that matter most. And this is a guy that knows from experience because he has counseled thousands of people. And so he came up with this series as a one last ditch effort, because he was saying in his first one, he goes, you know, I've counseled thousands of people, but you know what? They don't listen to me. So this is my, I'm going to try one more time. They don't listen to me, even to counselors. So starting over. Oh. Okay, now here's some funny videos about starting over.
Corey. I'd like to get a tattoo of my girlfriend's name on my arm.
Great.
Her name's Christina, with a Y. She spells it with a Y. Like C-R-Y-S-T-I-N-A.
Yeah.
And she also likes hearts, so if you could do like a heart. She likes the color blue and sometimes red.
Great. $200. Let's go.
Remember, it's Christina with a Y.
Yeah, I got it.
It's like C-R-Y-S. Oh, that's cold.
You're joking, right?
And a lot of times, life isn't as easy to clean up the mess when we are starting over. And so as we continue, these are funny with some of them. You know, I had a tattoo in one of my fingers one time, and it was an initial of somebody, and then I took it out. It was very, very painful. And so I've experienced a lot of these. Maybe you have too, or part of or something of the ones that we have. And so then we recover. You're still here today. You live through it. You're here. But you know what? Some of the most important scriptures that we can learn and figure out for this time in our life to not make the same mistakes over is Romans 12, 1 and 2. And he discussed that in the third one. Of rethink it. And same with this one. So I have those in your handouts, and the reason why I do is because it's a powerful word from God of what He wants to do for you during those times. And so I'll just read it real quick. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And so what happens when our mind is getting renewed and we're connected with the God of the universe? Things happen. I'm going to be sharing with you in a minute. I'm going to read to you the Message one. That's the Message Bible. It's kind of a paraphrase, kind of our lingo. I love it. It says, don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what He wants from you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity. God brings the best out of you, develops well-formed maturity in you. And what I like about with number three was he compared it to a transformer. This one is a rescue bot transformer. I learned all about that from my grandson. I didn't know what they were all about. So this guy turns into a fire truck, and which is really cool. And they've got these, you know, things that they rescue people. And I saw an episode with them. But that's what it's like. You transform. God transforms us from the inside out. We don't have to grit our teeth as much or show on a fake smile because God's doing something powerful in us. And it's for real. And so as we keep learning and keep growing, he also had this. He said, you just don't want to be a cookie cutter like everybody else. You want to be a transformer and be transformed from the inside out. And so that really stood out for me, and I just love that part. The other thing about this is, how many people here do not recognize these people? Who does not recognize them? Everybody does. Who? Who doesn't recognize them? Oh, okay. All right. These people,
Green Acres,
what were they were socialites from New York. And he always dreamed of having his own farm, and she was a socialite, which is a city girl. I mean, like, royally city girl. They lived up on a penthouse. She didn't know anything. And they wanted to try. So this is what they moved out into the country, and they started over. I mean, really, it's a really comical thing. And so as we see, if some of you, if you haven't seen it, you can look to it. But what the purpose is to start over. Some people start over drastically, like a whole new life. Some people just want to start over a little bit, one part of their life. And so everybody has a starting point. What is yours? Point number one. Does anybody here want to share, you know, in a couple minutes, a minute, of them starting something over, and they would like to share how that was? Whether it was successful or it was a failure, you want to start over again. Does anybody feel comfortable enough to share?
Starting over, being single, have to do everything by yourself.
And it's not always easy.
And nobody to ask how you do it.
And many of us in this room have had to do that. Anybody else had to start over something that they would like to share? Okay. Well, I'm going to share something. I have to start over. Starting from this week on Monday, I knew I was going to have to start over. This was our horse, Marshall. This is Scott, just a little after, maybe 6 months after we got him. It was in the winter time, you can see that, and he was mounting on him. His name is Marshall. We got him when he was 4 years old. And this week on Monday, we found out he had congestive heart failure, and we had to put him down yesterday. We had him 17 years. We didn't have him for five. And I'll tell you a little bit about that story. I'm going to tell you three stories so you can get to know a little bit about my relationship, Scott's relationship with this horse. It was not easy. We have to start over now. And this might seem minor for some people, but if you ever had a death in the family or a death of an animal or a loved one, then you might be able to empathize. So we find out Monday that he might have a few days to a couple weeks to live. So we had to make some decisions during our shock. We thought he would live at least another 10 years. He was only 21. And we were taking really good care of him. But we knew something was going on. Something just was not right. And because of my foot situation, I spoil my horses. I was not able to go out to the pasture as much as I had been wanting to. Because I would slip and fall. I'd already hurt myself how many times. You know, I was having relapses with my Lyme disease. So Scott and Luce and Rachel were going over, and they were taking care of the horses every single day. Well, what happened was he kept getting skinnier and skinnier and skinnier. We didn't get it. So we give him, how many pounds is that? 650 pound bale of hay. You know, we give him feed every day. We're probiotic, everything. We're doing everything we can. And then I saw him Friday and I said, this is not right. I need to call a vet. So I called a vet, and Talked to the vet on Sunday, came out on Monday, and gave us the bad news. We know some people that they get something, they get cancer, and they're gone like that. They get some situation. So this is what happened. We had to put him down. It was not easy. We had a lot of people mourning. He had touched people's lives. We had no clue how much he touched other people's lives until now. And that was so encouraging and such a blessing that of the testimonies. I'll give you a couple of stories about me and this horse. Well, Scott fell in love with this horse the minute he saw him and the first ride he ever took, and said, I want to buy him. The first time we went to go see the horse, I was with a friend of mine, Kathy Barrett, who happens to be a very horse friend. She's been my friend like for 20-something years. My horse mentor friend, and very connected horse-wise. And she had found out about this horse. So we all went. We took like 5 or 6 kids, 3 or 4 adults. We were all going to try out to see if this was going to be the best horse for us because we were starting a 4-H thing. So then we went, and everybody tried him out. Everybody fell in love with this horse. Everybody. So then we're hauling him home, and we said, oh, let's just take one stop. Let's go to this person's house, and let's go riding. I decided I was going to ride him. And I decided to canter on him. And he was so obedient and so amazing. And horse people understand, I felt like I was floating on air. And I fell in love with that horse. I said, wow, what an amazing horse. So, fast forward a little bit. Our back 40, I had made a bunch of trails for horseback riding. So we can go and go zigzag, 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 so we can get our thrills, you know? Because we couldn't always go to Governor Dodge. We couldn't always go somewhere else. So we get our little thrills going on our back 40, going back and forth. Well, I had this humongous hill all the way close to our neighbors that I kind of had made mowed a little bit. And one day, I was riding in bareback, and because his first owner had ridden bareback over her 300 acres everywhere for 2 years, and then she got cancer and couldn't ride him anymore. And so then that's when we bought him. Okay, so we're riding along, and then they said, why don't we go up that hill? So we're riding along, and I thought, yeah, I think it should be all right. Well, Marshall decided, he was so excited to go up that hill that he started kind of doing this thing and trotting up the hill, and I was bareback. And so I held on to his hair, his neck. I was like this, and my legs were over his butt, but I hung on, and we get to the top, and I thought, wow, this is fantastic. What an awesome thing. I held on. He was great. And then I started calling myself Woman from Platteville, because there was a movie called Man from Snowy River that, you know, I was going up the hills and going down the hills. And I just thought, man, that's what it's like. So I was just goofing around and calling myself Woman from Platteville instead of Man from Snowy River. One more story. One more story about my relationship with Marshall. What happened is, I have two more quick stories. Marshall, there was a time when Scott didn't want him anymore, and so it was time to sell Marshall because we didn't need another horse. So we advertised him, and these people came, and they said, saddle him up, ride him around. They did. He was perfect, perfect, perfect. The guy said, okay, we'll take him. And I said, no. And I started crying. And I said, no, you can't buy him. I'm sorry that you made your trip, but you cannot buy this horse. What? He was infuriated with me. I understood that. But I wasn't going to lose Marshall. I didn't care. Because I realized I didn't want to live without him. So here we go. We go now a couple more years. And then I'm on a ride, and I'm training these people to ride other horses. And I had a horse by then. Her name was Lacey. And she was wonderful, but nobody wanted to ride Marshall. So I always end up riding Marshall. And she was riding my horse. And we decided for some reason we were going to cross the creek. And I can't remember why in my back 40. And so the little girl crossed the creek with Little Bit. We had that little tiny miniature horse at the time. And he decides to run across the creek. And it's like going up his legs. And she's like, crying. You know, so then I go and comfort her and tell her it's okay, just hold on to him. And I cross back over the rocks or whatever I did and jump the creek. And then Lacey comes in and she's like pawing on the ground with that person. Then I come and Marshall decides he's going to jump and thinks he's under size or something. And he jumps the creek. He gets, because he had these big old, he had a big haunches and he like, and then, and I jumped across the creek. And I held on, and I felt like I was floating. I loved it so much that I was saying, yes, I made it. This was, oh my goodness, it was so exciting. And the woman looks at me like, you're nuts. You're a thrill junkie. And I said, yeah, yes, I am. So, fast forward another few years, and then a boy comes to our house and says, you know, I've been praying for a horse like Marshall. I've been praying a lot. And I'd really like a horse like Marshall. And we weren't advertising or anything. So we discussed it, talked with Scott. We sold them to this boy. He had them for about 4 years, 4 or 5 years. And then we just got them back 2 years ago because they were done. He grew up and they couldn't afford all the horses they had. And so we got our Marshall back. Because when she asked, would you like them back? I said, in a heartbeat. But let me talk to Scott. So I talked to Scott, and we got him back. And because God graced us with 2 more years with him, other people were able to fall in love with him and enjoy this blessing. And this is what I want to share today. We never know what God is going to entrust us with to bless somebody else. We don't. And so for us to see that. And so this week, believe it or not, folks, besides my Lyme problems and my relapse and family problems and situations that are going on, he allowed me to go through this situation this week so I would have a message for you, because I had to live this. I had to live it. I have to live these principles. I have to live it. And I didn't know if I was going to be able to even give this message today because I was bargaining with the Lord. Some of you saw some of my Facebook posts. And I usually don't show much of those kind of emotions on Facebook. But God said, no, I have to be real. I have to share. And people were praying for me this week. And so 17 years later, God has this lesson for me to learn. And throughout, for especially Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, he had been teaching me and encouraging me through people and situations. I just really, really believe that when we are connected to people, bless them, share with them, share life together, then when you're going through stuff, it can help encourage you. And we need that. As people, we need that. And so guess what was going through my head this week? It was, you're transformed. I'm transforming you through this situation so that you can help others be transformed. You need to rethink this. Because you know what happened this morning? Maybe I could have saved him. Maybe if I would have just done this. Maybe if I would have just done that. So what did I do? God said, no, you call Kathy. So I came in the house, called Kathy. No, you guys made the best decision. You couldn't have saved him. You know, but sometimes we're struggling with things. Regret, the song. We're struggling with things. We need to be able to call somebody. We need to be able to go out with somebody. I had a friend to go out with yesterday during the hardest part when he was getting put down. There was other things that transpired that were encouraging to me. And so when we're going through that and we see that, let's take those principles of starting over. I'm going to start over. You know what God said? And I'm just like, oh, man. And Bob, you don't need to be discouraged. You blessed a lot of people. You have two more horses to bless. To be blessed and bless others. You have two more horses. You can do this message. So, this morning, I wake up at 2 o'clock in the morning, boom, 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 my brain's going, and I finish this message, and I'm encouraged to encourage you that, yes, we can go through hard times, but that doesn't mean we're doing it alone or that we have to do it alone. And when we're starting over, and I know some of you, you're going to be there to help me start over. I'm going to be there to help you start over. We need each other. Whether it's a health, a marriage, a situation, a job, a problem. Let's uplift each other when we're trying to start over. And so, as we go on, the aspects of living on it. How do we make it practical? This is another book that I've been reading this week for my devotionals. It's Having a Merry Heart in a Martha World. And there's a story in the Bible about Mary and Martha, their sisters, and Jesus comes to their house, and Mary's just saying, I'm going to chill and listen to Jesus, and Martha's saying, I've got to get everything ready for Jesus and be the great hostess and, you know, and serve. And then she goes to Jesus and says, hey, you know what? Mary's not helping me. Don't you care? Wow, she was just saying to Jesus like that, don't you care? And she's saying, she has picked the better part. So that was, again, starting over. She's picked the better part of being with Jesus. That's what I was doing this week, being with Jesus. And this is what we need to do when we're going through trials, when we're going through things. War Room. On Wednesday, I had some friends come over to watch War Room again with me. Fourth time. I love it. I'm not getting tired of this movie because I always get encouraged. I want to encourage you. You want to watch it? You haven't seen it? Schedule it with me. I'll watch it again because every single time it was so encouraging. Every single time. So those are two things. The other thing I wanted to share was how encouraging Facebook has been to me during this trial. I put the dot in the wrong place. And so, whatever means God uses to encourage us, that's what we want to do. Call each other, talk to each other, bless each other, help each other. Because that's what we're put here for at BOL, Bread of Life. So, point number two, rethink it. Time is our friend. That was what he talked about in number one and two. And you know what? I believe it because that's how it was this week. And this is what he's telling me for number two. Time is my friend. Time is going to tell what's going to happen. And it all worked out. Now, I can't say I'm not going to have tears for Marshall. What resurrected were tears for my other horses that I had to put down. Tears for Grandpa Ricardo. Why did I think of him this week? I don't know. It's going to resurrect some other tears for other people. But then what happens is, yes, it was a good life. Yes, I loved, and I'd rather have loved and then lost than never to have loved at all. Than never to have loved at all. And so, as we move on, as we go on, there are lots of other people to love, and there's lots of other animals to love. And that's what God is telling me. Time is our friend. So as we take the next step, who recognizes this? As we take the next step, that's probably what it looks like right now.
The M.
Exactly. The world's largest M. As we take our next step, how many have gone on
the M?
How many have climbed the M? A lot of you have climbed the M. Yeah. It's not easy. It's not easy anymore. So on your next step, here are different things that you can do to start over. And if you want to see the starting over, the whole series, with me, connect with me. There on your sheets is a webpage if you'd like to see it online. But if you'd like to see it in person and we go over it, more than happy. And that's what I wanted to share with you, that as you climb them, this is a view from my house. And you can see my house, I'm not sure, from up here over here. And there's always a bigger picture. There's always a picture that God sees that we don't. And regardless, in regarding everything that we might be going through and the hard times. He understands. And so he'll reveal that to us as we take the next step in our situation. And I know that this is what we do. Now, I was really excited going and getting ready for my boys to come home from the other pasture this morning. But then, it's the first time that I went to the barn where Marshall had been for this week. And so then I was getting a little, you know, and then that's when I started getting these regret thoughts. So then I called my friend and she encouraged me. I talked to Scott. Encouragement. And then I can rejoice again that God is taking this and he has got the bigger picture. And he is going to bless. And I know it because he's done it for me in the past. And I know he will do it for you in the past. And so as we go, let us sing this song. For those of you who might be the first time you hear this song, but this is what he's going to do for us. And then I will have a closing prayer. Jesus, if you put the situation in his hands, let us pray. Our dearest Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for being a God that cares about every little thing and about every big thing. A lot of us are dealing with things. Some of them are big, some of them are little. But dear God, you love us so much that you don't want to leave us alone. You want to help us through them. And we just thank you. You want us to be an overcomer. You want us to start over with some things. And so, dear Lord, as we give them to you, we praise your name and thank you for the strength you're going to give us to get through. I pray for each one a special blessing. For all those that are here, you know their hearts and you love them. And so we praise you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Starting over and we need to live it. A reminder this week that the message will be available on Facebook if you want to see it again. The VBS pool party is tomorrow at 2 p.m. and February 14th is the Valentine's Day. We also have a fellowship dinner following this and everybody is welcome to join us. There's plenty of food. And have a great week. Don't know what the weather's going to bring, but wherever you do, do it with God. God bless you all.